So I'm really looking forward to coming back here on a permanent basis in the second half of next year when I finish teaching in the States. And thanks very much. It's been great. Great to be here, to be a real Sydney person. It's a pleasure and a privilege to be with my friend and colleague over many years. It turns out I'm only 5 years older than Imants, but that time shrinks as time goes on. And what we thought when I was asked to have a conversation with Imants, I said to Ros and Tony and to you that I don't normally, throughout my whole career, I've never done particular things for individual artists, particularly in a commercial setting. Okay, so I'm not here, and Imants fully agrees with this, we're not here to talk about his show and for me to be the normal art critic who promotes his exhibition. We're not doing that. What we're doing, we're going to try and weave a relationship between art critical, art theoretical, art historical practice, which is what I do, and Imants' work as an artist, which is also art critical, art theoretical, and art historical in really important ways. And it strikes me that we've had a parallel practice over all these years, as many people in this room have done and have been part of that same practice. And what we're going to try and do, we've picked out a series of topics that have concerned us both really since the late 1960s. And for maybe half to three quarters of an hour, we're going to try and weave a conversation based on those topics, where we both speak about our experiences of the avant-garde, of provincialism, conceptualism, Australian art history, indigeneity, contemporaneity. These apparently abstract topics, which are in fact for us lived, this is our life, this is our art, this is our practice. These are things that we've wrestled with, but we've also originated ideas about. Both of us have originated ideas about these things that have worldwide resonance. So we want to try and talk our way through those and weave a conversation that is somewhat parallel to Imants' practice in the studio. I've seen him in the studio where he kind of lays out not just images, but books and words, tags, concepts. He lays them out and then he sort of adds to them and he builds works of art across the floor until it eventually turns into one of these works. So we're going to try and recapture that, because something like that is what I do when I write. So we're going to try and capture something about that. So let's start with an idea that is now almost disappeared from our vocabulary. But in the late 60s and right through the next 20 years or so, it was a crucial beacon or a crucial idea about what art could be. That's to say, it could be avant-garde. The idea of an avant-garde and joining an avant-garde, creating an avant-garde, making an avant-garde possible, making it work. And for me as a very young student in Melbourne, learning about art from the artists who lived in Melbourne with my friend Geoffrey Shaw, who became a wonderful member of ZKM, and a leading artist, digital media artist. But at that point, he and I were schoolboys together, without going into all the details. His family and his family's knowledge of art was crucial for me as a young boy whose family did not have a great acquaintance with art. But I realized, when, for example, I visited the house and I saw someone playing a violin for the first time, his brother Maurice Shaw. He was playing one of Bartok's violin concertos. I never heard classical music before. He took me straight into that and instructed me, this is where you actually begin from. So the best avant-garde practice was something that astonished me as a young man and drew me to think about art, to want to write about art, to want to be part of that whole framework, which then of course was crucial to our early years at the Power Institute. But that's another story. Now I know, Imants, for you, the avant-garde was a major idea and a major world that you wanted to enter. So give us some picture of that for you.
Yeah, well, I grew up as, you know, the eldest child of immigrants who came to Australia as refugees. They'd been in a displaced persons camp in Germany where they met. I was the first born. So I basically grew up in a Latvian household. You know, didn't speak any English until I went to school. So I had kind of two lives. One was at home, where I was Latvian, and one at school, where I was Australian. And, oh well, as many migrants, my parents were quite poorly off, really. Grew up in the Sutherland Shire, Sylvania Heights, when it was the outskirts of Sydney, southern outskirts. We had no art in the house. And my parents were very interested in education. So I was a really good student, you know, primary school and high school. My mother took me to a couple of exhibitions in the city. I saw Nolan's Riverbend at the Farmers Blaxland Gallery when I was 15. I also saw that exhibition of American art that was at the art gallery, I don't know, in 67 or something.
So, 67, yeah.
Yeah, and I kind of entered the local art exhibitions, Rockdale, which was near, you know, near Hurstville.
Yeah.
And evidently I won a prize, for a children's prize at the Rockdale exhibition when I was 8.
First up,
and then, well, I think in 1970, Donald Brook judged one of the Rockdale Art Prizes, and I won.
Surprise.
And he was subsequently, you know, at Sydney University, and a big, you know, proponent of new art, which he called post-object art. So I had a very sheltered childhood, you know. Didn't have Australian friends at home, or didn't go to any birthday parties anywhere.
Right.
So when I went to university, it was kind of like an explosion of a new
revelation.
Yeah, new world. And I studied architecture because, even though probably I could have gone to art school, my father wouldn't hear of it. He said, you know, if I'm an artist, I'll end up in the gutter. And he was someone who studied in Australia, you know, after he arrived here, part-time at night-time, and became a mechanical engineer, which was quite something. He was failed actually once due to his poor English.
Right.
So it took him, I don't know, 6 or 7 years to get it. And, you know, other Latvians that he was friends with, you know, one of his best friends was happy actually to work as a train conductor on the railways his entire working career. So, you know, education was extremely important for my parents. So therefore, you know, studying architecture was like a compromise.
Okay, quickly, the parallels here are absolutely extraordinary. We mustn't get too autobiographical. In my family's house, there were two works of art, two reproductions. One was a very famous painting of a beautiful Balinese woman with a blue face by Chelyachev. Do people know this work? A reproduction in the main room above the fireplace. That was wow. And the other thing, the only other image in the house was in the main corridor. We're not talking a large house at all, but a main was a calendar, and every year it had Albert Namatjira paintings in the calendar. Those are the only two images. I discovered art when my father took me to see Farlap in the Melbourne the Museum. If you look at the stuffed body of Farlap reflected in the vitrine, the glass around it, you could see in a vitrine behind these amazing things I thought were the best cartoons I'd ever seen. They turned out to be William Blake's illustrations to the Divine Comedy. And then halfway up the stairs, I saw a few more cartoons I saw in another vitrine, William Blake's etchings to the Book of Job. If you keep going upstairs, you could suddenly see this amazing landscape of things, paintings, landscapes by Streeton, it turned out, naked ladies. I'm 9 years old, right? 9 years old. Naked ladies, still life, incredible. It just went room after room, the National Gallery of Victoria at this point. So that's was never, Urschlerhoff put those Blakes deliberately there to attract people like me out of the museum up to the thing up the top. Anyway, we're getting too autobiographical. Let's go to avant-garde. So what did avant-garde mean to you at that point?
Well, I was very fortunate to actually, you know, be in the architecture faculty in 1969 at Sydney University, because there were a few, it was a new year of a, first year of a new course. Yeah. So it was 6 years instead of five. And they had a few, they had a couple of guys from Berkeley. One of them was Mar Grounds and the other was Sam Sloan. And they were tutors in design. And Ma was very, very out there. And so when Christo was going to do his rap coast, he said to first year design students, you know, if you don't want to do the third year design project, you can work on Christo. So about 10 of us volunteered, including me. And even though I'd never heard of Christo, you know, I didn't really know what he was doing, really. It was quite a powerful experience. And I did meet another kind of enfant terrible. I wasn't one of those, but it was Ian Millis, who was actually, he's only 19, but showing with the, you know, at Central Street.
Yep.
Terry knows him very well, I think. Anyway, he told me, well, he was quite friendly, and he said, you know, there are two things you need to do. You need to subscribe to Art Forum, which actually was a really avant-garde magazine in the early 70s. And he said, you should join the Contemporary Art Society and show with them. So I did both those things while I was still doing architecture. And, you know, it was my introduction to the idea of the avant-garde. I mean, prior to that, maybe I thought Brett Whiteley was pretty good, even though I don't anymore. anyway, well, you have to keep learning. And the idea of the avant-garde really excited me. And I wanted to be part of it.
Okay, so my parallel at that particular time was I was a tutor at the Power Institute, Bernard Smith, as the director, and we taught courses on modern art. Our first year courses were the history of modern art, then we went back in time. The architecture tutor was the lecturer was David Saunders, and Donald Brook was the lecturer in sculpture, and I was the assistant to these amazing people. The idea of an avant-garde was absolutely crucial in Sydney at that time, as it was around the world. It was assumed that modern art could continue to renovate itself, could continue to be an avant-garde practice. In the way it had been for the previous 100 years, at least 100 or 150 years, if you want to originate all the changes in the middle of the 19th century with Manet and Courbet. and have all the isms coming from that point onwards. The assumption was that the crucial thing for an artist to do, or a group of artists in particular, was to get together and imagine and create an artistic practice which would be so powerful it would change all art all over the world from that point on forever. That's the height of the ambition. We don't have that now. That's utterly gone, that idea. But that idea, which at that point it was understood would mainly occur in New York or London or somewhere in Europe. It had never happened in Australia, and that was one of the great disappointments of the history of Australian art, from our point of view. The 9x5 group was the closest moment for it occurring in Little Gallery in Melbourne in the 1890s, but the possibility of generating an avant-garde here, why not? Let's try and do it here in Australia. So the Central Street, Pinacoteca in Melbourne, artists of that generation, just a few years older than Emma's, but absolutely my peers, Tony McGillick and all of them, let's transform artistic practice. And the way we're going to do it, and this is where the provincialism comes into it, the way we're going to do it is take the most advanced practice that we can learn about from the magazines, not just our forum, but then Avalanche magazine and many other magazines like this. What's the most advanced practice that we can understand to be happening in the world? Let's do that to a greater extreme. Let's do more of that. And let's do that in a way that picks out one of its characteristics and really pushes it to the point, for example, of reshaping canvases with singular colours, Michael Johnson and so on. Let's do this in a way that takes whatever's happening overseas this further step. So something like this opens up not just a different way of being avant-garde, it opens up the possibility of turning over your provincial situation, which is one in which you're sort of dependent, or what I, as I define it, subservient, culturally subservient to what's happening elsewhere. There's a possibility of turning that over. But here comes the conceptualist, not so conceptual art, but the conceptualist aspect of this. You can only do it if you can, as it were, step back from the practice, reimagine it as if it was a practice of thought, and then shift it to another level in terms of what you might do in a studio, for example. This is what I think. This is what I think Imants picked up. Whether you would have articulated in that way at the time, probably not. But I think you did eventually, and you—that's, I think, what you picked up. So, am I right or wrong about that?
Yeah, you're right. Well, actually, to continue the Sydney University story slightly, I was able to do my fourth year thesis between the Power Institute and the Architecture Faculty, due to Peter Johnson being the professor, that's Tim Johnson's father. And so I actually had Terry as one of my supervisors, who did actually send me Avalanche magazine, which I wouldn't have received otherwise, and introduced me to Ian Byrne, and it wasn't Jeffrey Shaw, but the other guy.
The Event Structure Research Group.
I did actually, is that not going? Anyway, I did interview both of them, and so even though Terry was in New York, he did actually mentor me to a degree. In 1974, Terry, while he was based in New York, wrote an article for Art Forum, and it must have been the first time an Australian's written for Art Forum, maybe. Yeah. It was called The Provincialism Problem, and it was just about that issue of how, well, you know, if you're not in the centre in New York, you know, your work is sort of secondhand, you know, like hard edge painting came to Australia with a lag time. But Terry made a mistake, which is that he illustrated the article with works from the Mildura Sculpture Triennale.
Yeah.
So it had artists like Bert Flugelman, Ross Grounds,
yes,
a few others, and their work looked like imitations of American land art. So even though that wasn't really the point of the article, it sort of infuriated me.
Oh.
So I thought, I don't like this take.
Okay.
Yeah, so I kind of reacted against it, but it was a powerful influence.
Okay. Oh, let's respond to that, because I've never heard that point before. That's amazing. So the article was indeed, the first work we showed was Ross Ground's Ecology Well, which to me is still one of the great works of Australian art. And the fact that Ross did not continue very much after that to produce art gives me great sadness. But it was also illustrated by a work by Bert Flugelman, John Armstrong, Nigel Linden, Ty Parks, all of which I would argue both reacted to what was happening in art elsewhere, but also in each particular case took a step further forward than what you could see in the journals. That wasn't necessarily obvious to everyone here at the time. It becomes more obvious as you go along. But the crucial thing about that article, well, there are many crucial things, and Ian McLean has written some wonderful commentary on it. But to me, the crucial thing was to describe a power structure in the whole international art world, clearly centered in New York, but a structure that had to generate an avant-garde transformer every few years to keep the system going. And which obviously made every art from everywhere else in some sense subservient to that system and needed to be fed through that system. And to me, that was an oppressive system, and artists around the world were, what I was describing was a situation that was intolerable. Not that I was recommending it or people, you know, we were stuck in it. I said, at the moment, we can't help but be provincial. Everyone is provincial. The point is, Sol DeWitt was provincial. Larry Wiener, who just died yesterday, was provincial. Everybody involved in the system were locking themselves into a kind of enslavement that was going to prevent avant-garde practice from emerging from this point onwards. That was the point of the argument. That's what drove everyone nuts. But you're probably right about the illustrations. I don't agree that they misrepresented the article. The illustrations didn't fully represent
but
the article.
You did change the illustrations in a later version of the same thing, which was in Paul Taylor's anthology, Anything Goes. So there you had actually illustrations of Fred Williams' show at the Metropolitan.
Oh, did I? Okay. Yeah. I forgot that. Paul must have done that. Okay.
No, but I think the, you know, we realise that every place is provincial, but the provincials in New York have far greater reach and, you know, far greater kind of you know, their work's actually looked at by everybody. If you come from Australia, no one's really going to pay any attention, really.
Okay. The other thing that strikes me is those, Tom McCulloch gave me those images from Mildura. And, you know, Tom had just created two Milduras and he then went on to the Sydney Biennale. So a phenomenal series of curatorial interventions, fantastic. You know, curatorship of a kind that we only saw later from Bernice and, you know, Nick Waterloo. And we had some great curators in Australia, but the Sydney Biennale, I think, was really energised and given its strongest definition by Tom in those first things. But that's the Biennale. he had an idea also of an avant-garde, but he recognised that an avant-garde was occurring all over the Pacific Rim, you know, and that's a way of stretching the power structure, the New York down power structure, and making it more lateral. That was a profound idea which has continued on since then in echoes, you know.
Well, I think, you know, I mean, I was terribly impressed that, you know, Terry wrote this article in Art Forum, you know, having begun subscribing to it. And, I mean, in a way, I was very interested in the Art and Language group because here was a group that had an Australian member who, you know, did have an international presence. And I tried to understand Art and Language. And I never did, really. But the other conceptual artists that I liked, Terry says, were kindergarten versions of conceptual art.
Well, when I use that phrase, that's the phrase, we even used it about Joseph, our dear friend, and now my dear friend, Joseph Kossuth. That's when you make a kind of art that illustrates the concept rather than is actually driven by the conceptual issue that you're struggling with. Ian, so crucial, so central. Art Language was a group at one point about 20 people, but really the core group were about four or five. Terry Atkinson in England and Michael Baldwin. Then Ian Byrne and Mel Ramsden. Everyone else, all the rest of us, were peripheral to these two. So Michael and Terry in England drove the first years of Art Language. And Ian and Mel drove the other phases of it. And conceptualism, I've tried since then to make the idea of conceptualism a broader idea than conceptual art. For example, when Imants evokes Robert Rauschenberg in those two paintings over there and makes us, the Rauschenberg is evoked by the pink splashes, because what Rauschenberg did in a work called Factotum, I think in 1962 or... Factotum. Ah, that's better. That was a slip. Notice that interesting slip. Yeah, Factum. Two facts. He painted one abstract expressionist style painting and then reproduced it almost exactly right next door to it. And what that did was explode the idea that every work of art is something that comes out of your soul and is unique and can only be produced in that form at that time. So the underbelly mythical theory of abstract expressionism is blown out the window by this gesture. That's an avant-garde gesture because it clears all previous art for a new kind of art.
This is in 1958.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's incredible. Yeah.
So abstract expressionism was still...
Absolutely dominant. Yeah. And so that's a conceptual. Another one is he asked Willem de Kooning, about whom I was writing my master's thesis, by the way, he asked him for a drawing that he could erase. And de Kooning thought, Jesus Christ, here's this guy. He wants to use me to advance his own career by making this banal gesture of, you know, obliterating, I'll give him some crappy drawing. So he first picks out some drawing and figures, and then he says, oh God, it suddenly dawned on him. This Rauschenberg guy is a friend of John Cage. He's not stupid. He also realizes that most of my practice as an artist is about erasing what I've just done. He's actually going to try and do something that takes what I do and take it a step further. I'm going to give him the best drawing I possibly can that I've done lately, which is what he did. And you end up with this amazing thing, which if you look at it very carefully, it's an extraordinary effort by one artist to repeat the work of another artist while disappearing it at the same time. Right? So that's a conceptual act to, you know, it requires you to think the thing through from front to the back to think of all its implications and to execute it in a way which leaves a residue, a visible art residue that changes the concept of art for everyone who looks at it. So it's a conceptualist work. It's not a work of conceptual art, because we did that later. But you know, anyway, sorry, comment.
Yeah, no, I think it's an amazing work. And yeah, I mean, anyway, I guess my work in the 70s, I would call post-conceptual, not really conceptual, but in 78, I did this work based on two reproductions of a Hans Heisen painting called Summer. And I did it with this new technology, which was called Necco, which is basically a scanned, you know, computer scan of the image, and then it painted it onto canvas. And I showed that in, so there are two divergent paintings on canvas of the same image. It was shown in the Sydney Biennale, I got in 79, and I got this British artist, Robin Coombs, who was teaching at Sydney College, who was quite interested in it. And David Truestwick was the other British artist teaching there.
Yeah.
And they were both kind of interested in this, and they were interested because they couldn't really pin down what it was.
Right.
So Robin Coombs sort of said it was a kind of conceptual work, right, to do with reproduction of imagery. But I think actually it was like my first postmodern work, right? And it was to do with appropriation, which hadn't really started as a movement in New York at that moment.
So I want to just, let's get into a debate about postmodernism in a minute. But what I wanted, because these work, you also did the work, the Duchamp Heisen switch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Conversations.
Yeah. Conversations, yeah. So that work, Conversations, I think is really important. And it's also echoes in these two paintings we've got over here, in the sense that Arthur Streeton did a couple of pictures of the Sirius Cove and Curlew's Camp. He did quite a few pictures. I mean, they're tourist paintings, really. You know, I mean, they're wonderful little paintings, but they're really done for people walking by so he can sell them to make a buck. So he's repeating himself in a way.
Well, that's why I did this work, because actually it's obvious that he painted from almost the same position. But his two works were done four years apart. So that's why the images are slightly divergent.
Right.
So it is actually a kind of reference back to Untitled in a sense. So that was kind of, anyway, the whole postmodern thing is really interesting.
Yeah, but you know, it's a kind of, it doesn't disappear Australian art, right? It doesn't, nor does it disappear in art that's made somewhere else. It actually animates and suggests that there's a field of connection between art made in two different places, two different times, and so on. You know, it's appropriation, yes, but appropriation for a purpose.
Yeah.
Not for no purpose, you know. Not random. It's not random.
No, not at all.
No.
No, it's kind of very purposeful. And in fact, you know, when I had the opportunity then to, through John Caldor's show in PS1, you know, I got a gallery in New York and had, I don't know, four or five shows there. And I was very, so I sort of had a different approach, which was to kind of, kind of quote artists that would be familiar to the audience there, like German, you know, artists Kiefer, Baselitz, Richter, and New York artists, you know, Schnabel, etc. And in fact, it kind of was a pretty banal strategy, but in fact, it was quite effective. And you know, it got me kind of, it was mainly a critical response. It wasn't actually collectors or anything like that.
Yeah.
So I became part of the kind of expressionist versus the kind of postmodern group. So I had critics like, you know, Kim Levin supporting me, and then local, you know, the opposite camp to the neo-expressionists kind of came to my shows, and like Philip Taff and Sherry Levine. So it kind of made me feel as though I was sort of part of the debate. And people like Donald Cuthbert gave me really bad reviews, which sort of meant I was more firmly in the other camp. Anyway, but I changed. I changed after a while. And
but let's stay with that, because what's always fascinated me is something I think is prefigured in those works that comes out very clearly. We see it even here, but in your, say, the big paintings like Diaspora, you know, when you move to the Book of Power, you know, when you actually start to think on a scale where we're not, you know, we're not appropriating this image from here and this image from there. And what I'm searching for is a way of asking you about something that I was very concerned with during that whole period, and as always have been. But it's an art historical, this is an art historian's perspective, you know, because art historians look not only at individual art, works of art, how they relate to all the other work by the same artist. Art historians also look at how works done by artists working at the same time relate or don't relate to each other. And of course to previous art and so on and so forth. So we're looking at the flows through time and across space, across the world, across different parts of the world. We're looking at fields that are spatial and fields that move through time. The whole provincialism, way of thinking about provincialism, was to try and think about a world, an art of a whole world. Again, something Ian made clear. I didn't fully understand that was what I was doing, but he did, he does. So there's a kind of world field. So my question, at what point did you start to think about what I would call a world field, meaning one that in fact is global and you can take images from bits of it and move them around and move them through time?
Well, I think that's a crucial question.
Yeah.
And for me, it was actually the political events with the fall of the Berlin Wall. And then, the Baltic, you know, if you were Latvian, I mean, there are a few Latvians here. You know, if you said you were Latvian in Australia, people wouldn't know what the hell you were talking about.
Where is Latvia? Yeah.
You could look at a map and you'd never see Latvia on the map. You'd just see the Soviet Union.
Yeah.
And so in 91, when Latvia, or the Baltic states became independent, well, in the 70s, I'd read an article in an economics magazine that said, the Baltic states would never be independent because it would take the collapse of the Soviet Union for that to happen. So the Soviet Union did collapse. So then actually my whole focus really changed. And, diaspora became a kind of crucial concept. I mean, David Malouf actually introduced me to the word diaspora. And, that describes so many people, you know, in Australia, but also throughout the world. So I became interested in, the post-colonial, but it wasn't the Australian post-colonial. It was countries like Latvia, which had been colonised, you know, by the Soviet Union. So it sort of resulted in a complete change of direction. So I suppose that's where a more world view, you know, started.
So is this like being able to see the world's map, if you like? I mean, to constantly envisage the sort of maps of the world with countries as actors and events as somehow energizing actors. And in some crucial way, that map, that world map, or that, we're not talking necessarily about continents and oceans, you know, that's, when I say world map, everyone thinks either globe or you think continents and oceans. But most of us actually carry world maps that are sort of relatively fragmented and incomplete, but they're very strong pictures of what the larger world outside what we can see and what we can imagine as being, say, within Australia and so on. We actually constantly have, as a sort of a conceptual a conceptual subjective or underlying format or framework or an unfixed flowing framework. We're always operating this. It's occurred to me for a number of years that Imants actually has this as an animating thing, that behind particularly some of your larger works, and when you go upscale, you know, you think, I'm wanting to show people how this array, you know, this worldliness operates, and I want to show how these images are crucial now compared to those, and you know, something like that. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. So with the first work I did was called Diaspora, and I showed it in fragments in Riga in 1993, and then it was purchased by the National Gallery in New Zealand.
Yeah.
And anyway, so I've done, actually this work is the 11th in the series, so every time I wanted to say something major,
yeah,
I would sort of do it at this scale.
Go big and produce a masterpiece, which you're not allowed to use that phrase at the moment. But they're statements, you know, big. It's very interesting you mentioned 1989, because that's for art historians, that's the classic moment at the beginning of contemporary art. You know, I think that's too fixed a way of thinking about, because it implies that everything that happened before 1989 was somehow modern. Everything happened was, that's obvious nonsense. But the fact that 1989 did trigger, not just for Europeans, you know, and those colonized by Europeans such as us, but throughout Africa, almost for 20 or 30 years, there have been processes of decolonization going on. Within Australia, since the 60s, from the tent embassies, decolonization have been occurring. So there are many kinds of, shifts of world pictures occurring that were calling out artists and historians such as myself, writers, to think about them in different kinds of ways. Not too many people take this burden on, and I'm glad that you do.
It was quite a pivotal moment. So I think that's when actually globalization of the art world started to happen. You know, you had all the former Soviet, you know, republics. Those artists were now, you know, theoretically able to join the rest of the art world. So the sort of, the Europe, New York kind of axis, I think, started to collapse.
Right.
And then there was also the sort of all the artists from China. I forget when Tiananmen Square was was around the same time. Yeah, so suddenly there were artists from everywhere.
And that's also where I developed, well, starting with the fact that in Australia we have more powerfully than anywhere else the presence of Indigenous art. And the growth of Indigenous art from the 70s, but really, which really took off in the sort of mid-80s and became an enormous force in this country, obliging everyone to reconsider what were the fundamentals of our practice and museum practice and dealerships and, you know, how we went about art altogether. That's a big worldly decolonizing, you know, it's post-colonial, but actually decolonizing paradigm shift that occurred that triggered for me the sense that there are going to be contemporaneous sets of forces operating within art in Australia that will really shift the whole thing in such a way that they're not going to merge, though, you know. In some ways, there will be mergers, there will be conflicts, there will be misunderstandings and so on and so forth. But fundamentally, Indigenous art practice in this country comes from cultural settings and forces and has powers that have trajectories through time that are very old and are going to go for very long, and they're on a different historical path from many of the others that are here, themselves very diverse, as we've just heard, in terms of immigration and so on and so forth. So the job for critics and historians becomes to map. How do you map all those things that are occurring? And that's why I've developed ideas about contemporaneity. The contemporaneity of multiplicitous differences, none of which are inherently greater in any sense. They may be more powerful and more forceful and have more energies and resources, but they're not in and of themselves inherently greater than others. Right? So that the contemporaneity of our differences becomes a sort of fundamental. And what that does is knock out the idea that there's this historical development will take over this one and wipe this one out. And it also knocks out the idea there will be a new avant-garde that will wipe out all this art, and, you know, that's all useless. It means that the many different kinds of art practices will keep on working together and contest back and forth with each other. Now, to get that point back to where we are, some Australian artists, among them yourself, become aware of this, but also had the, if you like, the conceptual equipment and the emotional need, commitment, to continue making their art in a way that would absorb these changes, comment on them, be disrupted by these changes, okay? So, anyway, have a comment about that.
Yeah, no, well, you know, I think the Papunya Tula movement is quite crucial, you know, in Australia.
Yeah.
And I think it started in 1971, 72. You know, Jeff Barden in Central Australia.
Yeah.
But I only became aware of it really around the early 80s, 81, 82, mainly through Tim Johnson originally.
Yeah, Vivian.
And then Vivian. And then Tim. I became, thought this was amazing. And I thought the imagery was pretty amazing. So I kind of wanted to, yeah, so since then I sort of just wanted to find out more. And I did, you know, start referencing Aboriginal imagery to my sort of detriment probably early on, because, you know, while you could borrow freely from anybody else, you know, no one's going to...
Describe a moment where that came to me. I was in London at the ICA. Do you remember you had a work in that?
I very well remember it, actually.
Was that the White Aborigines work? I can't
remember. No, it was, there was one work which actually was a pure quotation for a Papunya Tula artist who I've forgotten. And yeah, can I describe what happened? Because.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, having a show at the ICA, a solo show at the ICA, is one of the high points, you know, for me. And I even had Sidney Nolan commenting on me in an interview with Peter Fuller, you know, who's this young upstart.
Total pain in the ass.
Pain in the ass. And so there was a seminar to do with the show, and I forget, there was a very annoying person in the audience called Terry Smith, who sort of asked me some, sort of off-putting questions.
Yes.
And So I was kind of defended by Megan Morris, who was on the panel, and Homi Bhabha, who is quite an important cultural theorist. So I've always wanted to find out, well, now I know why, I know, you know, why you did that, but...
I think it was the one, is it the one called Antipode and Manifesto? I can't...
No, it wasn't. It was... I've forgotten what it was called, but it was just a pure quotation of an Aboriginal
Anyway, so I slammed Imants for just appropriating without transforming, okay? And I'm sure, and everyone else defended him like mad, but I was right.
Well, in retrospect, it doesn't seem like such a bad moment, but it probably made me think. And the other one was The Nine Shots, which actually was a very popular work that, you know, combined Georg Baselitz and Michael Nelson and Jagamara. Yeah. And, you know, later, due to Michael Ether, I sort of started collaborating with him.
Yeah.
And Michael just wanted to do more and more works.
That's right. Well, the Nine Shots work and the, you know, Gordon's response to that was so important. The ricochets, the nine ricochets. So the I remember when Bernard Smith asked me, which images should we have on the covers of the update of Australian Painting? He gave me that responsibility. And I had no doubt that the Arthur Boyd's scapegoat painting should be on the front cover, because it was such an astonishing picture by an Australian artist who, it's actually a painting of a ray fish that's basically being destroyed and raped by an Australian Anzac soldier. You know, it's a violation image set down probably in the Shoalhaven. So it's such an anti-Australian nationalist picture that I just had to have it on the front cover of this book on Australian Painting. But on the back, I know I had to put in a work by an Indigenous artist. I couldn't put a work by an artist from a remote community. That would just be too banal a thing to do. And by coincidence, I'm walking into an exhibition in Brisbane. It's just in a local foyer of a building, and there's, you know, Nine Ricochets. So it's absolutely, so those two at a certain point in the 90s for me really shaped where Australian art was, but also made us remember that, I mean, Arthur Boyd's done a lot of pot boilers like Sidney Nolan has, but both of them have also done some quite subtle thinking about history of art and the history of art in Australia. We're getting onto naturally into one of other topics, because Imants, I think, is one of the important historians of Australian art. Imants, this one here, not this artist. He's actually an art historian as well. So is Juan de Villa, you know, Boyd, no, many of our artists have, even in peculiar ways, some of John Olson's reflections on what it is to be both a Ubute country, you know, they celebrate a banality on one level, but they also, you know, question it to some degree on another. So we do have a bit of a history of this here. And I think there's in this country, in the way we do our art history, this will be known to some people here, but not everybody. We are very well known for graduates coming out of Melbourne University and the Power Institute in particular, for being very conscious not just of how we write the history of art, but how our predecessors have written, and how it's being written differently in different parts of the world. What we call art historiography, the history of art history, the methodologies of art history, are a very important part of what motivates the kind of art history that we actually write. And there's a parallel, because artists such as Imants, because of this conceptual history. He may not be a conceptual artist, but the demand that you take a sort of meta position, in other words, you think above the actual practice, you think about the practice while you're making the work, you think about its theoretical and historical implications, that's a demand on you that is not as common, for example, in artists in America. In the United States, some artists, you know, the best artists obviously do. But people like Warhol, who began as in quasi-concept, you know, they understood something of this, gradually disappeared that consciousness in their art. And here it's actually quite strong. It's one of the things that is quite outstanding about this country. It leads us to think about our questions of nationality. And when you talk about postmodern, it's a post-national way. I mean, Charles Green and Ian McLean and others are developing this idea of post-national art history here. All of these things feed into this idea of, you know, it doesn't mean you're after questions of nationality. It means precisely that, you know, they are problematic for you. Questions of a nation are constantly problematic. You know, one of our favorite words in art language is not that we have problems we can solve, that we have issues that remain problematic and will keep generating art for us, making us work, making us try and answer them. Anyway, so I'm doing a quick trajectory through our list of topics because we're probably heading to almost talk for an hour and we want to leave some time for questions, but please, Imants.
I like that summary. Yeah, post-national.
Getting in the post-national direction. Yeah.
I mean, I've had this strange thing happen to me, which is I had a big exhibition in Riga in 2018. And now I'm being written into Latvian art history. With earlier works.
That's right, yes, yeah.
So you are. So I'm kind of, it's a strange feeling being part of two kind of narratives.
Yeah, let's underline that point because I was lucky enough to see Imants' show in Riga, in the National Gallery, the beautifully rebuilt National Gallery they've got there in Riga. And where they, you know, huge, wonderful retrospective they did for you. But one of the aspects of it that I'm not sure we see very often here, maybe you have shown the works here, but not as much. There was a whole dimension where he's also appropriating and reworking and putting together in unexpected ways key imagery from the history of Latvian art, but also from Latvian popular culture and decorative forms and so on.
Yeah, well, I was doing that from the early 80s. But it was kind of unknown to the local audience.
It was invisible to people here. That's what happened. Okay, so Tony, if questions, we can do it, it's fine. Any questions or comments? Up the back, sir. Please stand up and be clear so we can hear. Yeah.
Over the last few decades seems to have naturally settled into a pejorative term, a negative term.
Yeah, no,
particularly by the generations who weren't aware of how contested a term it was in the 1980s, whereas usually by those against it associated with a lack of originality and a superficial trend. The things you've said today, particularly where you use the word diaspora, made me think that you're closely aligned with the idea of the postmodern being political. And that connects then to the idea that it is a decolonial project in the way you were talking about it and kind of paralleling it to the way Latvia separates from Russia. So postmodernism separates from modernity, which was an annihilating colonial project, which is reborn in the whole centric periphery argument. So a political postmodernism that we hardly ever hear about anymore is embodied in that kind of work and some of the ideas you mentioned.
Oh, well, thank you. I mean, that's a great comment. I've decided to, embrace the term postmodern. I mean, this Australian-British academic wrote a book called The Postmodern Art of Imants Tillers in 2002. And I know it's become a pejorative term, especially for, the newspaper critics like John McDonald, and the others. But I think actually postmodernism was more complex and deeper than that. And actually it initially applied to literature and architecture. Mm-hmm. So I've just decided that, it's actually not a bad expression at all. It's just been, kind of misinterpreted. And I'd like to kind of identify with it again.
Okay, let me respond totally differently to that. Mainly because in the 80s, when the term started to circulate, it did in fact first begin to be used within literature, even though Bernard Smith actually claims to have used it first. But it really meant artists after the first generation of great writers, like Joyce and Beckett and so on and so forth, the next sort of generation called postmodernists. So it wasn't particularly very thoughtful use of the term. And then, of course, Jean-François Lyotard came up with this key text, The Postmodern Condition, where he was actually, if you read the text carefully, the first person to fully identify the impact of computational thinking on philosophical thought, art and knowledge. And it's actually a very good text from that point of view. But it became kind of adopted as the announcement. The other great part of his argument was that the major, what he called legitimating narratives of the modern period, such as Marxism or the idea of progress or within the arts, the idea of modernism, all those ideas had lost their force and we're in a state after them, which he then went to identify as somehow being back inside them. Anyway, then comes, these ideas start to circulate during the 80s, and they're adopted by many people, including Imants, who wrote this essay, Locality Fails, and Paul Taylor took it on for Australia. Really, what Paul was doing, I think, was promoting a kind of post-structuralist version of postmodernism, with talking about Roland Barthes very. And the anything goes notion that he had, I opposed very strongly, because for me, what was being argued was that we're in a state where everything was basically equal to everything else and anything went and do whatever you liked, whatever, whatever, whatever. And it was impossible, therefore, to commit to any kind of values or even particularly to value locality, which actually you profoundly do. Your whole art is about valuing locality in a condition where locality and belonging is tenuous, unbelievably tenuous, and becoming more and more tenuous all the time. So we see behind us what happened to locality in the southeast coast of Australia in the 1990s, and came near where you live and where we have some property as well. So the locality can be obliterated. It's very tenuous, but it can't be just trifled with and thrown about, which is what a lot of postmodern practice seemed to advocate during the 80s. And it generated incredibly superficial architecture and relatively poor art, such as Julian Schnabel. I mean, it took years for David Sully to become understood as a seriously interesting artist. Most of the other people who, and Basquiat as well, but many of the other people are really terrible artists, I think. So it goes like this. So if you reappropriated Imants, you've got to watch that you may be carrying some of that. Since then, obviously, you know, contemporary art or contemporaneity, you know, frameworks such as that, I think, because I've promoted them, encompass all of these changes and differences much more, much more adequately than the idea of postmodern. But I can see, in a way, what you're doing is you're being faithful to your trajectory. You know? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's probably partly true, but I'd probably, preparing for this discussion, I kind of looked at different period, different phases, and you know, I've been an artist for 50 years. But 25 of those years have been spent in Cooma, you know, rural New South Wales. And I think there's been quite another change, which is that I'm very interested in landscape, but I'm also interested in, well, it sounds pretentious, but I thought, and being, like, what is it to kind of, not just being in the landscape, but you know, how does one interact with a landscape, or what does one see in a landscape? Yeah. And so I'm very interested in that. And yeah, probably the worst person to mention, but I find that, you know, I'm interested in, Nietzsche, but also Martin Heidegger is actually writes about being,
yeah,
and, you know, place. So I kind of read him as poetry, you know, not as a philosopher.
Right.
So that's actually been the focus for me,
yeah,
for half of my career.
It's true. It's interesting to hear these comments, because the idea that landscape could attract you as a ground of your practice in the 1980s, that'd be a total joke, right?
Yeah, total joke.
Absolute joke. Because any, or still life, or portrait, or whatever, any of the structures, the whole point was to, even of early postmodernism, the whole point was to make radically provisional all the things we take for granted about practices of art making, including landscape. So otherwise you're going to turn into the current version of Arthur Streeton, right? And I must admit, when I looked at some of your work about 20 years ago, I thought, Imants is turning into Arthur Streeton. Arthur Streeton, in the later phase of his career, you know, he not only produced the great, you know, Still Guides the Stream and all these fantastic national pictures, but he also produced what Ian Byrne pointed out, a whole, like, Australia Felix, and you know, the late landscape paintings that we saw, fabulous things. But Bernard, you know, when Bernard started writing, Arthur Streeton was this angry old man, you know, against whom he was dedicating his whole career. That's because Streeton was a really conservative art critic in the local, in the Age at the time. So that's a sort of detail. But it's a fascinating thing to return to the sort of grounds of being when you've developed an artistic language that came out of a context in which all of the elements, the bits and pieces, the practices of appropriation, the idea of accumulating by an already given system, the book of power, every panel has a number, everything, that's a total conceptual art thing to do, to apply an arbitrary system to the chaos of life, right? An arbitrary organizing system applied to the chaos of life, which will actually make more manifest the fact that life is chaotic, that being, in fact, is chaotic.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I owe that to coming into the art world, you know, at a time when conceptual art appeared.
Yeah.
So, Yeah, so it's also enabled me to have a build a practice. You know, I think the most important thing for an artist is really to find a way of working that sustains you and keeps you going.
Yeah.
And yeah, a conceptual idea like that really helps.
Well, you'd be interested to know that one of Joseph Kosuth's favourite sayings is that, which he often reminds me, we don't paint, we don't draw, we don't create pictures, we don't work in a medium, we develop a practice, we develop and build a practice. That's what we do. Yeah.
Yeah, no, that's fantastic.
Okay. That's a good thing to end on. But questions or comment? Any other? Oh, hang on. You've had a go, so you can't have two. Somebody else? You can't have two if no one else puts their hand up. Yes, please. Yeah.
I need to ask a question that you can't.
Ivan, please. Take it. It'll be a good one, so I'm sure we'll hear what you say.
Well, it's the metaphysical question. The metaphysica australis, and it's all around us.
Hold it up.
Sorry.
Speak, yeah.
Can you comment on this? Because it's really strong.
Well, I think, you know, part of landscape and being is that, you know, being is not just physical, it's also, you know, metaphysical.
Yeah.
And so I'm kind of interested in both those aspects. I mean, when we moved to Cooma, I started a series called Nature Speaks, and I've done almost 300 works in that series, but they were never pictures of landscape. They're always kind of evocations of landscape, you know, through both text and imagery.
And language.
And language, yeah. So that's still kind of continuing. I mean, some of these are more literal, but, you know, that aspect hasn't disappeared.
No, another thing that struck me, let me just read you this. Let's see. 20 years ago, when I first arrived on the plains, I kept my eyes open. I looked for anything in the landscape that seemed to hint at some elaborate meaning beyond appearances. My journey to the plains was much less arduous than I afterwards described it. And I cannot even say that at a certain hour I had left Australia. But I recall clearly the succession of days when the flat land around me seemed more and more a place that only I could interpret.
Gerald
Manane. That's the opening of the Plains, you know, the great book of 1983. Led to so many other. It's always struck. Well, it hasn't always. It struck me for the past 20 years, and it's maybe because Cooma is in the same geological district as northwestern Victoria, where he, of course, writes within about 30 mile perimeter. But Manane, I'll say something strange now. Manane not only reminds me of my father-in-law, whose family had a strong relationship to major parts of our landscape, but of Ian. Ian and I were born in Geelong, but somehow he had a stronger sense of the Western District than I did, and I think that came out in his later writings about national landscape. And he's also, Ian was a in character, reminds me of Gerald Manane, not in the sense of someone who was a recluse, but more this Australian white male of the 50s with very clear and strong picture of what the world was like or should be like, you know. But also someone incredibly responsive to the world's physical structures and to its light. Light. So Manet, more than Ian, is a poet of our of Australian light in that area. So I'm sensing that you're you have a feeling for that, and that's coming into your work a lot more.
Yeah. Oh, well. Yeah, we're probably coming to the end, but I mean, you know, the minute we live, Cooma is in what's called the Monero Volcanic Precinct, and it's actually a naturally treeless area, which is quite unusual in Australia. And it's quite a harsh landscape, both in terms of climate and appearance, but I'm really into it, really, and the austerity of it is quite powerful, and the vistas are quite very powerful.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, we moved there. We didn't deliberately move there, but we moved there because we were offered a place there. So it was by chance, really, but it was lucky.
That's probably it. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Okay, great.